Summer's in the... Hey Ninja Lovers, I'm your host Love Ninja and I welcome you to my channel, a place where we talk about dating and relationships and flirting and...
Something's in the air right now.
Using personality theories such as the Myers Briggs system and the Ennegram system. So today I want to talk to you about the INFP personality type and how they flirt. So who are the INFPs? They are the dreamers, the idealists, the romantics, the lovers, which is true. I am a lover and I fall in love every season. I think I've fallen in love 3 times in the span of 8 months this year. Because love is my drug. Love gives me that high. And love is what I live for. Everything else in life is a distraction. And that's why I started this YouTube channel, right? Because I love and want to talk about it. And this video is deeply personal because I'm an INFP and I've had to do a lot of research into figuring out my own patterns of behavior when it comes to flirting. Because self-awareness is not something that comes naturally, right? You have to pay a lot of attention to your behaviors and your motivations and ask yourself questions, catch yourself in the act and ask yourself questions and face some uncomfortable truths about yourself. Okay, so I'm laying myself bare out here for you so you may benefit from this content. And before we plunge into this content, I just want to let you know that although I talk about stereotypes here, because stereotypes are fun, I don't mean to fit all INFPs in one box. Every INFP is different, right? Just like the vanilla ice cream from Ben & Jerry's is different from the one that you get from Cold Stone or from Naturals if you're in India. So let's get into the content. So how do I flirt? So if I like you, I will make sure that I don't make the first move. You heard me right. Because I'm an introvert. That's what the first letter of the 4-letter code INFP, that's what it stands for, right? Introversion. And as an introvert, I like it when people come to me, right? When I don't like to initiate, whether it's in terms of like dating someone, like a romantic context or any social situation, right? Even for friendships, like I don't make the first move. It's not just because I have this big ego, but it's also to do with the fact that I am afraid of rejection, right? Who isn't? So it's super uncomfortable for me to put myself out there like that. So if you like me, honey, you walk up to me and ask me out, right? That's not to say that I haven't taken lead ever in relationships. I certainly have. That's not my natural preference as an introvert. Okay. Secondly, but I'm not passive altogether, right? When I like someone, I make lots and lots of eye contact, okay? And it comes up in like really awkward situations, right? When it's not supposed to. I remember this one time I was getting tested for COVID and there was this healthcare professional in his PPE. He was masked up and gloved and everything. And there was something about him, right? Just the way he moved, his confidence and the way he seemed busy, the tone of his voice, there was something about him that got my attention and I started paying him a lot of attention with my eyes. And he almost accidentally swapped my eyes, no kidding. But yeah, so I make lots of eye contact. It's only because I appreciate, there's something about your physicality that I appreciate and I want you to know that you've been seen by Miss INFP here, that I see you and I like you and I'm crushing on you. But if you dare to walk up to me to strike up a conversation, then I'm going to pretend like I didn't see you, I didn't hear you, none of this happened, you don't even exist. And I only do this because I am too embarrassed that I've been caught by you, caught in the act. And I'm too red in the face and I'm shy and I just want to die. So that's how it kind of plays out for me is I make eye contact when I'm into someone, right? I don't have like, I've just realized that all the things that I do, the way I respond to a crush and his interest, this isn't an effective dating strategy, but as INFPs, we don't let effectiveness govern us as much as our emotions, right? And we're super emotional. We're slaves to our emotions. But one thing I've noticed about myself is that I tend to be a whole nother person, like a different person when I'm online, right? Like I sort of metamorphose myself. I'm more extroverted, which means that I give a lot of energy and to you, if I'm into you. And I really don't care about letting you see my edge, right? I would cut raunchy jokes with you. I would do wordplay, innuendo, tease you, any type of reactionary stuff just to get your attention. And if it's an anonymous platform, like Reddit, for instance, then I'm going to be like super brazen with you, right? I don't withhold myself at all, like my thoughts or feelings. And I tend to be like this commander personality, like an ESTJ, right? I take control. That's how I am when I'm online. And so I give you all this energy, right? So when you write a standard platitude to me, like, how are you? And I respond with 10 lines. And you just give me back like a one word response. Then I'm going to do a slow fade from the conversation altogether. Because heck, I'm giving you all of this energy, right? I'm extroverting with you. And I want you to... And I'm trying to actively amp up the emotional state of our minds. And you're trying to diffuse all of that, right? So I'm going to pull back. And I expect you to match my energy, if not trump it. I want you to heighten my emotion. And if you don't do that, then yeah, it's bye, honey. Anyway, okay, another way to tell that an INFP, if you're having a good date with an INFP is when you show an active interest in topics that they closely follow or that they're passionate about. As an INFP, I've noticed that I don't have like a wide bunch of interests like ENFPs do, right? And with ENFPs, we share... the same cognitive functions, but the order is different. But yeah, I don't have like a whole bunch of interests. There are only certain topics that I read into like very closely and passionately, mostly abstract topics like philosophy or like subjective interpretations of paintings, movies, like pop culture, all of that, right? So if you show an active interest and if you start asking me a bunch of questions and I'm sitting there gesticulating a lot and there are like dramatic tones in my voice and I get louder and my hands are up in the air, that's a good sign. That's I'm flirting with you. I'm really enjoying this conversation with you because you're talking about stuff that I dig, that I care about, right? And I tend to be selfish that way. Even though I might show an interest in things that you like, I'm just secretly, silently waiting for that opportunity where you turn it around and put the spotlight on me. And I want that spotlight. I want it really bad. Even though as an INFP, I tend to be a background person, right? At least in a group situation, I don't like the spotlight on myself. But when it's like one-on-one interactions, then for sure I want that spotlight. I want to be that professor. I want to educate you. I want to grab that power. I want to be that authority figure. And that's the motivation. So if you let me have that power, if you, you know, shine that spotlight on me, I am going to shine, baby. Okay. And I'm also going to end up liking you more in the process. So yeah, so if I'm all animated with you, then that's a good sign. You know, it's my way of flirting with you. But that said, I do play hard to get, okay? And this is a very frustrating thing, but I do give mixed signals a lot, okay? And the way this pans out is like, I would invite you in, you know, joke around with you, flirt a bunch and laugh with you and amp up the emotional states of our mind. And then when you want things to get real between us, when you want to hang out and, you know, get closer into my physical space, I will pull back. I will draw myself. And why do I do that? I'm going to get into it. Okay. So there's a part of me that wants to live on the edge. Okay, and there's also another part of me that feels threatened, that I could fall for you way before you do. And yeah, and I have these big feelings for you already, and I don't want to talk about those feelings. I want to keep them guarded. Because what if I told you everything? I mean, would that be creepy? Would I push you back? You know, would I scare you, intimidate you if I let you in on these feelings that I have? So when I play hot and cold, it's because I'm like processing all of these emotions, right? And I'm trying to evaluate them, and then I'm trying to figure out, is it safe for me to share these feelings with you? Is it too early? I'm asking all of these questions. And so to keep you away from me, I start getting like all sarcastic, and I do this weird thing, right? So I've noticed in past relationships, it's like, not relationships, like at least like with my crushes, I think I've told them a lot of I hate you rather than I like you. And I've also said like a bunch of rude things, like, why don't you get the fudge out of my head, for instance, right? And that's when I'm really feeling it, and I'm into this person. And so yeah, that's how I do the mixed signals, right? And again, there's more to it, there's more nuance to it, as to why I do it, and I'm gonna get into it. But I can only get into it by talking about another concept, which is idealization. Okay, so beware that if you're in a relationship with an INFP, or if you're forging this new bond, romantic bond with an INFP, that INFPs tend to idealize their romantic partners, right? And so I'm just gonna take a step back and talk about idealization. Okay, just go into my past. So as I was growing up in the 90s, there's obviously no YouTube or Netflix, but I was consuming a lot of content, right? There was TV and TV shows and books and video games, and there was Hercule Poirot with his sexy brain, and the wrestler Randy Orton with a sexy body, and there was Thane Krios from Mass Effect, right? If you've played that game. And there was also Fitzwilliam Darcy from Pride and Prejudice. Okay. So all of these fictional characters, I was infatuated with them, right? I fell in love with them because they kind of awakened this well of emotions within me. So I formed an attachment with these fictional characters. And so when I start crushing on you, chances are that there's something about you, right? Just the way you talk or your attitude to life. the phrases that you use, the tone of your voice or your appearance, there's something about you that kind of reminds me of these characters or makes me think of myself as one of the characters in these books or whatever, right? And you've obviously done something to trigger those fantasies. So when I'm infatuated with someone IRL, it's because there are chances that they remind me of these characters, and I sort of re-experience that attachment which I had with these characters as I was reading them while growing up, which is a good thing, right? So you're kind of stoking my imagination, and that's what I want you to do if I want to have a relationship with you, you know, actively stimulate my imagination. At least that's what I look for. I don't know about all INFPs, but for you, for me, yeah, that piece is really vital. But idealization is also a bad thing, right? I mean, it makes me only notice the good parts about someone, but it's also a bad thing, just not for myself, but also for you, my romantic partner. Because I expect you to match your behaviors or just follow the same trajectories as those fictional characters, or at least in terms of the way you respond to me and my attention and give me attention. I have all of these expectations of you. And if those do not line up, then I am disappointed that you are not that fictional character I imagined you to be. Okay, there's a lot of dejection there, a lot of disappointment. There's also a lot of despair. And so when I'm playing hot and cold, it's... So let's say that, you know, I started getting to know you and you reminded me of this character that I fell in love with. And you made me... You triggered all those emotions within me. So I started liking you even more. But then you did something that was not congruent with the way the character behaved or responded in the book, right? This fictional character. So then I am off-put. I am dejected. I am disappointed. And it's scary for me that these fantasies are just going to be fantasies, right? So when I'm not hanging out with you, it's because I'm afraid that I'm going to have to say goodbye to those fantasies, because this is getting real, and the more real it gets, I have to come to grips with the fact that you're not this character. You are a different person, right? There's something about you that reminds me of these characters, but you're not this character. You are flesh and blood. You're different. Your mind works differently, right? So there's almost this fear of confronting reality. And also, again, this piece is confusing, but I'm going to say it. It's also the fact that, so when we started talking and I showed you all of this interest because you reminded me of this fictional character, right? So I shared a lot of intense feelings with you, right? I kind of like amped it up for you because I really truly felt those feelings because I'm authentic that way. But emotions are fickle things, right? The garden gnomes, they're pesky. And so if we hung out like two or three times in a row and I was so intense with you in the beginning and I shared all these feelings with you, now I'm afraid that I can't keep up the act anymore because you're a different person and you no longer remind me of this fictional character, right? So I'm afraid of confronting you. I'm afraid of letting you know that, hey, I'm not into you anymore because you're a real person and you're not this fantasy that I have been living, right? For the past 3 weeks that I've interacted with you, right? So I'm afraid. And I'm afraid. And that's why I don't want it to get real. And at least, like, I mean, I've noticed this piece come up a lot when, not so much when I meet someone, you know, I've just met someone IRL, then it's a lot different. But let's say, like, we just met online and all I've seen are your, like, pictures, some blurry pictures and things like that. Sometimes I'm even afraid to ask whomever I'm interested in to share more pictures of themselves with me, because I feel that they might look different than my imagined version of them, right? Something to that effect. Yeah, because I daydream a lot. And so I'm always trying to constantly fit in people, fit in situations with these idealized images or versions that I have running up in my head. So that's how my mind works. I'm letting you in on how I think, right? So idealization is a big piece, and it is confusing, frustrating. And it doesn't make sense, but that's how it is, right? I just want to let you know how the INFP brain works. So, okay, I'm just looking at my notes here. So all you need to know is that I have a relationship with this character first, okay? And this relationship is sacrosanct for me, this fictional relationship that I have. And so when you don't match up to this idealized version or image, then I am crestfallen, I am dejected, and because my fantasies are going to end, and it's painful for me. It's really painful for me. And what's even more painful is that I don't want to confront you about this, right? And I don't want to, and I can't pretend anymore, and I have to confront you. So confrontations are like, they're just difficult for me. As an INFP, I don't like confrontations at all, okay? All right, so what happens if you break through this, these hot and cold inconsistencies and this icy coolness that I have, is you get an intense lover, right? Because I am an intense lover, right? I have dossiers on the men that I have crushed on, right? That I crush on, and I online stalk them, right? And I store all of the information that I have about them, right? Can be like irrelevant stuff that's not even important, like the types of the way your hair sits on your head, the clothes you wear, or the phrases that you use a lot, your go-to words, I mean, to describe your mood or like how you're feeling, stuff like that, right? And I would, or just the way you laugh, like the way the facial muscles move in your face, and I'm gonna like mimic or mirror you when I like you. I do that as an INFP, right? I start mirroring my crushes. I use the same phrases, and I start taking an interest in things that they're interested in, the books that they have read, the movies that are their favorite movies, right? So I start mimicking and mirroring my crushes that way. So again, if I tend to do that as an INFP, or just like kind of write the way you write, like the expressions that you use, whatever, that means I'm into you, I'm flirting with you, okay? This is one way for you to know that. And I'm a sponge, and I will absorb you, right, if I like you. Okay, also as an INFP, one thing I've noticed is that with my crushes at least, and not just crushes, like even romantic partners, I tend to get very quirky in terms of like gift giving, right? The ideas that I have for gifts. Again, this may have something to do with me being an Ennegram 4. And I haven't delved into Enneagrams right now, but just know that as an Enneagram 4 personality type, I really, I can't do ordinary, right? Whatever I gift you has to be something special, something unique, I can't give you like functional things like a spoon or a fork or a wallet, that type of thing, right? So I remember this one time, there was this co-worker of mine that I crushed on in one of my earliest gigs in my 20s. And I think I gifted him a magnifying glass and a light bulb. And I wrote him a note. And I think the note was like, I hope your future is bright enough for you, or your future is clear enough for you. It was sarcastic and it was quirky, and that's what I did. I was a secret Santa, so that's how I tend to get like quirky and everything when I'm into someone, right? Okay, another marker to tell that the INFP likes you is when they start coming up with like random quirky nicknames. I think like one of my crushes was into White Pockets, and I would just call him like Mr. White Pockets, Mr. Two White Pockets, because White Pockets are functional, right? So I would come up with like quirky nicknames for my crushes. I tend to do that a lot. And if I call my crushes by their full names, that means I actually love them and I want to get married. Sorry, I've not been feeling well, very phlegmy, and I've been coughing a lot. Also, as an INFP, if I'm crushing on you, then and if I'm comfortable with you, I would start joking a lot, right? And my humor can be like finding connections between like two random things to disparate things. Or I also tend to do a lot of wordplay, which is like, I remember this one time I was crushing on this guy, and I told him how awkward I was with first crushes with like random strangers or acquaintances, and I misspelled the word awkward because I wanted him to know how awkward I get with first hugs. So that was my kind of quirky humor, and he seemed to get it and he liked it. So when I do this type of stuff, it's like, yeah, it's to get your attention, and I'm being funny and flirty, and yeah, that's an indicator again. And if we met IRL, then you could just pick up on, like, it's so obvious, right? I would blush a lot. I still do. Even though I am pushing into my 40s, I blush a lot, I smile a lot, I giggle, I do full-on belly laughs, right? So that's how I tend to get when I'm crushing on someone. Okay, again, checking on my notes again. So another thing that you need to know is as INFPs, we are really, we let our emotions, our moods and feelings govern us, okay? We are slaves to our emotions. And we are committed to our feelings first and foremost than our romantic partners or romantic interests. And I have big feelings, right? Even if I've talked to guys for like just 2 or 3 weeks, chances are that I've already got feelings for them and I'm in love with them and I'm ready to drop everything and just run into their arms, right? So I have like big emotions and big feelings and big fantasies and all of that. But I don't necessarily communicate that. I do a shoddy job of it. Like I said, I'm like sarcastic, right? And again, that has to do with my attachment style, which is a mix of anxious and avoidant. So yeah, I'm sarcastic, right? And I would say hate you rather than I like you. But there are other subtle ways in which you can pick up on the fact that I'm flirting with you is, or like I really dig you, is when I start getting not just sarcastic with you, but I communicate through, like I would send you links to my favorite YouTube songs, for instance. Not my favorites, the ones that remind me of you in certain ways, right? That kind of summarize our relationship or the themes in our relationship, right? So I'm looking for these themes Like, who do you remind me of? And what does our relationship remind me of, right? So I would probably send you like a bunch of songs, or like I would share memes with you or emojis, stuff like that. So when I do this type of communication, it's because I'm flirting with you. This is how I communicate, right? Not in direct ways, but yeah, through indirect ways. Okay. All right. So I think I've pretty much covered everything here. The push and pull bit, right? Playing hard to get is the confusing, exhausting, frustrating part. But that's what you get when you date an INFP, at least the ones that have the anxious avoidant attachment style. Okay, so be prepared for a lot of mixed signals. So that's my deep dive into the INFP mind when it comes to flirting, the context of romantic relationships. And if you're an INFP, I would love to hear from you, and let me know if any of this resonated with you and did I miss anything here. So drop me a line in the comment section, or you could drop me an email if you are like me and love writing emails. So my email is emaillovenanja@gmail.com. And if you found this content useful to you, if it's helped you understand yourself better, then please do like this video and subscribe to my channel. And I am eternally grateful for your support. And as always, don't be complacent. Love you, love me, and love Ninja.